I'll just take a moment and say thank you for sending me all the thousands of maps. The last couple of weeks I've been going through them like crazy. And I'll tell you, if you talk about a moving experience, it's studying your work. Because your work is really covering, is really examining, is really coming up with solutions for virtually all the challenges that we're facing across the globe. From national security to environmental problems to overpopulation to conservation of nature, all these things. This is why I feel so strongly about you. And I think the best way to get to know you is to share a little bit of the work. These maps show, for example, your work in environmental modeling and assessment. And I won't go through them all, but I'll share a few. The map in the upper left, looking at oil pollution simulation in the Moscow River, or environmental nuisance modeling in France, or look at the beautiful work by the Nature Conservancy in looking at landscape resilience modeling. It's pretty profound. In the world of natural resources, your work is improving agriculture. It's looking at finding petroleum exploration sites, and in forestry, more sustainable forest practices. But I'm very attracted to the one up at the upper left, where the Woodside Energy Company offshore in Western Australia used IBM Watson deep learning machine to connect with GIS to understand and predict better their core drillings. And then, since my family is in citrus, I was very attracted to the one on the lower right, which is looking at space-time modeling of a little disease that's wiping out citrus in Florida called psyllids. Most interesting map. These next examples show your work in land information, managing the cadastre, or the foundation for the civil society, really. These parcel maps are interesting, but what I'm attracted to here are all the forms of analytics that you can make out of it, like predicting vacancy in Philadelphia, or doing automated assessed valuation. Or look at this cool map in the lower left, which is looking at the income from each property and the expenditures, public expenditures on property. It's kind of a geo-accounting. You get it? It's sort of like a quick. In the field of urban design and urban planning, your work is working on creating a better future, doing urban design work, comprehensive planning like the city of Seoul, or resort selection over in Kauai in Hawaii, and all the analytics associated with urban planning that brings the science of where to life in planning. These examples show GIS going deeper and deeper into buildings and urban areas. Look at this beautiful visualization in Sweden. An urban planner came up with an idea and he wanted to share it with the citizens, so he made this animated film. And in the lower right, the containment structure modeled in City Engine for containing the nuclear waste tragedy that happened 3 decades ago. And it just goes on. In transportation field, GIS is now being used across almost every mode of transportation to model possible interactions and flows of traffic to real-time traffic monitoring. And you can see in the center, Waze, this marvelous crowdsourced information that people are collecting, is now being integrated through partnerships between you and the Waze organization, where you're sharing street closures, and your streets come alive with real-time GIS information. It's very, very fascinating work. In engineering, GIS is being used for facility management, like water and airports and so on, but it's also being used as a framework for work order management, managing the work that must be done. And you can see this beautiful map here showing the statistical history of where work has been performed. That's powerful. Okay, right away your eyes are drawn to the lower right in the utility space in New Jersey. We can walk around now with augmented reality and see the pipes under the street. That's so cool. And look at this neat map in the lower left, which is energy shed modeling. This is kind of like watersheds. It's looking at the shed by Oak Ridge National Labs. They modeled where the energy is coming from to support urban centers across the US. And then lots of other examples of use. In the commercial sector, GIS is being used by you to pick the right sites, like gas stations in India, or new business analytics in Brazil. But over on the left, automating routing in Iceland and in Denmark. And look over in the upper right, demographic modeling for banking. Okay. But my favorite is the one right in the center, and that's being done by Driscoll's. How many of you buy berries from Driscoll's? Yeah, most of you, I suppose. What they're now doing is GPSing every row while they pick the berries, putting it in those little plastic containers, and they track it, track the sort of food security of food right to the market. I'm fascinated by that notion. In these important subjects of like public health, we're seeing GIS used to illuminate things like the opioid epidemic that's happening here in the United States, and also pick the right locations for healthcare and social service centers. But look at here in the lower left, where we're using demographic modeling to show well-being in communities like Philadelphia or predict voting behavior. Clearly, our communities are safer because GIS is making maps not only of incidents like here in Japan, but look up in the upper right here, I'll call your attention to the machine learning crime prediction work going on in London and also in Rio de Janeiro, which is now being shared with the public. Well, we have a long history of using GIS, you, in preparing for and responding to disasters. And here we see everything from volcano monitoring to prediction to real-time situation awareness rooms, and then managing situations like damage assessment in Sri Lanka. Now, a new chapter has opened in the last couple of years, which is one of citizen engagement through portals, open data portals, open access portals, but increasingly this is coming alive to be more than just open data. It's maps where people are being requested to give input back, like in the UK, citizen reporting of events or 311 dashboards. But look at the map in the lower right here. This is a map that's been made totally from scratch in a couple weeks. It's the mapping of villages through crowdsourcing. And I don't know how many of you in this room participated in this, but hundreds of volunteers working with the GIS Corps mapped all the villages by looking at air photos and online air photos. These maps are important. They're providing the foundation for polio eradication immunization programs. And just magically, instead of spending millions of dollars, crowdsourcing made them come alive. These beautiful maps of cartography, like look at this neat one in Switzerland, the Swiss Topo. Now they have automated all the scales of maps at Swiss Topo. They're just beautiful pieces of art. And the geological survey in Utah has made it come alive on the web, both 2D web mapping and also 3D web scenes that you can interact with and play with natural resource maps. In the last couple years, the publishing of maps has just totally changed. Story maps have come alive, and all of the things that I showed you, all those dozens of slides that I showed you, every one of them has a story. It's quite an interesting story. We could probably spend an hour just talking about every one of those. And things are speeding up. Story maps now are being produced by the thousands every day. I'm just shocked by this. My good friend James Fallows, who's right here in the audience, invented a term. He called it geojournalism, and that's what's happening. Millions and millions of views of these maps are made every day on issues like climate change or social conflicts or inequality or where to take a vacation or scientific work. It's quite extraordinary.